Okay, so I guess we are live and recording. My name is Mary Elizabeth McIntosh. I'm a counselor here. I know some of y'all, so it's good to see some familiar people. We're going to talk about time management, and I know that a lot of y'all have maybe heard a little bit about time management from ACA, so I don't want to dwell on ACA too long. I want to maybe tell you guys some stuff that maybe you don't know. The candy is here, but wait until afterwards to take one. If you want to take one piece now, you can, but if you wait, we'll get more later. So, anyways, you can have one piece now or you can wait and then have a whole lot later. Okay, so what did we learn in ACA about time management? What specific did we learn, though, about what you do to manage your time?
We did, with the sheet, mm-hmm. We kept tapping on the time of, like, a time log.
Yeah, the tracker. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you looked at how you were spending your time. Mm-hmm. Anything else that y'all remember from ACA?
We graphed the time.
Yep. So you made the little chart of the time. Yeah, that's always interesting. People say that's helpful to see how they're spending their time. Mm-hmm. Other things, you probably talked about having an agenda or a calendar of some sort. We talked about to-do lists, all that good stuff, which is great. We also talked about the whole idea of just do it. You know, that's actually in your ACA book if you missed that. And if you look up, Sheila Buff has some sort of motivational video, which it's kind of loud, so if you're curious, look that up. Sheila Buff, just do it. He kind of yells at you on the computer. Mm-hmm. But it can be motivational for some people, I don't know. So anyways, what I wanted to do today is cover some things, suggestions on time management by a man named, by the name of Dan Ariely. Has anybody ever heard of that name before, Dan Ariely? Mm-hmm. One person. Yeah, Cocky's probably read some of his books.
Yep.
Yeah, so he is a famous behavioral economist at Duke University, and he's written a lot of bestsellers. And one of his areas of interest recently is time management. So trying to understand people's behaviors. Why do we make the decisions we do behind why we spend our time? And one thing he writes is, you need to recognize first that the world nowadays is working against you. The world is working against you in a time management way. When you hear that, what do you guys think? The world is working against you as far as time management.
It won't wait for you?
It doesn't wait, yeah. But think about all the maybe distractions that we have nowadays that maybe 100 years ago. Cell phones, TV, social media, video games, all of these things that are in our face constantly. Everything's vying for our attention in ways that maybe our grandparents' generation probably just didn't even have to worry about at all. So it's almost like you're kind of walking around on the street and you've got all these different things. Maybe your phone's going off. Maybe you've got a tablet, a computer. You've got things beeping at you, people messaging you, calling you. Stuff going off constantly vying for our attention. Well, Dan Ariely says that he kind of looks at that like we're surrounded by a whole bunch of thieves on our time. So it's pretty extreme as far as an analogy, but thieves on our time. And do y'all know what a pit pocket is?
Mm-hmm.
It's a pit pocket. What do they do?
Pick your pocket.
Literally, pick your pocket. Yeah, they steal from you. So he thinks of the things that maybe steal our time, that we don't want them to steal our time, as pit pockets. And a lot of times, how do pit pockets work when they're stealing stuff from you? They sneak up. They're creepers. They sneak up on you. They distract you. Keyword, they distract you, maybe unknowingly. They distract you, and they're maybe there's a street show or something, somebody performing, but then his buddy over beside him and his pit-pocketing people. That happens in big cities all the time. So Dan Ariely makes this analogy about all the different things around us and all the distractions are kind of like pit-pockets, and a lot of times they creep up. Like, has anybody ever gone on to social media and said, I just want to check on this one thing, and then an hour later, 2 hours later, you're still on there? You don't even know really how you got on there to begin with. Has that ever happened? Raise your hand if that's happened to you.
Well, not 2 hours.
Maybe 30 minutes. Okay.
Because I don't like.
So you're better than some of us.
I would read a chapter and I'm like, oh, I'll get it, not so much.
Yeah, but that does happen. We get distracted easily. So what do we do? Well, Dr. Ariely says that we need to banish distractions from our environment. We need to identify what the distractions are. So find them, figure out what they are, and figure out what you can do to get rid of them or minimize them. Google did an experiment with M&Ms in their, I think it was their New York office, and what they did, and this was an experiment they did on their employees. I don't know if they had their permission or not to do this experiment. But anyways, they put M&Ms in little baskets, and the employees at any time, there was no cost to the M&Ms. They could just go in the break room and get the M&Ms anytime. They just had free-flowing M&Ms. Well, then they decided, okay, well, let's see what happens to the amount of M&Ms if we put lids on these baskets or put lids and containers out for these M&Ms. So they have to go through an extra effort of getting it. What do you guys think happened?
Less.
Yeah. So 3 million M&Ms less were consumed by the employees in the New York office because of the lids. They put a little barrier to the distraction. Isn't that interesting?
Were they in clear containers?
I don't know if they were in clear containers
or not.
That
would make a difference if you can see it.
If you can see it. But even if they weren't, just having the lid versus having them all out in baskets.
Yeah, it's easy access if it's without it,
Yeah, so think about the things in your life that have easy access that without even thinking, mindlessly, you're having to do. There's a little bit more mental effort if there's a lid. You've got to think, okay, I've got to open the lid. I've got to reach in, maybe get the spoon. Anyways, if they're just kind of out in the open, a little less mental effort. So think about that as far as maybe your remote control to your TV. Where do you keep that? Does anybody ever just come home and they just turn on the TV automatically? Go in their bedroom, turn on the TV. Some people, some people are willing to admit it. Some people aren't telling me the truth. I know y'all do that.
I just like it for background noise.
Yeah, I like it for, it doesn't distract you. Okay.
I don't watch it.
I just turn on my phone in for music for me.
Okay, So maybe, maybe some of y'all, it's not distracting. But maybe some people, you know, you just turn it on and it's originally just background, but then you get sucked into a television show. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that can happen. Other things, so apps on your phone. If it's on your phone and it's an app, it's easy access, right? And if you're in a time, maybe it's during exams, maybe you've got a really busy semester, you may want to consider deleting that app. I'm not saying delete your Snapchat account. Just get it off your phone. Mm-hmm. You know, make it an extra step where you have to get onto a computer or something to use it, where you're not just walking around and like, huh, I think I'm just going to check Snapchat without thinking about it, or Instagram, whatever you guys are using. So create a little barrier with the distractions. And you can see we've got candy out, and it's very tempting. It smells really good. So we're kind of creating a distraction there, which we'll talk about in a minute. The other thing they found, there's been some research done on employees and productivity. They looked at who was the most productive. Didn't matter the rank, the level, the employee. The most productive employees were the ones who did not allow distractions into their office. So whatever a distraction was like for them, they had a space that was free of it. They got rid of distractions, and that contributed to their performance. So the next thing I want to talk about is just creating some type of system, some type of calendar. Does everybody have some sort of agenda, wall calendar, Google calendar, reminder? How many people have systems? Raise your hand. Yeah, most people have systems. If you don't have a system, get a system. one thing they found in research recently is that calendars make us happy. Isn't that odd? Like, people who have calendars, it somehow makes them happy. I think part of that is just having some sort of idea of what your day looks like and not having to make a decision for every single hour. If your day is already planned out, that's less worry, less stress for you to have to think, okay, I need to do this now, or what do I need to do? You don't have to ask questions. You just go basically off your schedule, right? So if you don't have a calendar, get one. Write something down. If you write something down, you are more likely to actually do it. It's more likely to get done. Mm-hmm. That's true with goals. That's true with time management, a lot of stuff. So if you say it's important to you, then you need to write it down. Okay, questions on that? Questions on anything so far? Okay, the other thing that Dan Ariely has studied is all hours are not created equal. So all hours in the day. They found, and I think we cover this in AC a little bit, they found that there are certain times of the day that people are more productive. When do y'all think people are more productive?
Midnight.
Midnight? Okay.
What? Mornings.
Mornings. What do y'all, anybody else?
Noon.
Noon? Okay. Different people have different ideas.
Is that the time you wake up?
No, I'm productive in the morning.
personally. So you're productive in the morning. Yeah, and some people it varies, but research says for most people, the most productive time is a little while after you've woken up. So probably an hour or two after you've woken up, you've got this period, they call it like the productive high period. So if you've got a major project, you've got something big due, find that time of day where you're going to be most productive to get it done. And I think from an office point of view, they say most people are more productive from around 9 to 12. In the afternoon, it's interesting, people kind of lose self-control. In the evening, people kind of, you know, relax a little bit. They're not quite as focused. So all hours aren't created equal. Remember when your peak time is and use that peak time wisely. Now, I know some people said, I'm a night owl, I need midnight. I know there are some people like that. So if you really are productive at a later time, then that's great and it's working for you. Awesome. I have a sister-in-law who's an artist and she works at 11 midnight. She is not a morning person at all, though, so she's very productive at night. Interesting thing, though, they've also looked at times of day when certain things happen. So apparently diets aren't usually broken in the morning. They're usually broken in the afternoon or evening. Again, that's that self-control. Crimes of impulse, that's where somebody's maybe just walking around and then it's not something they've planned, but it just kind of occurs to them, okay, I'm going to commit this crime. It happens in the evening or at night. People don't have the crimes of impulse in the morning, generally. So it's interesting stuff. So structured procrastination, has anybody ever heard of that term?
No.
It's not an ACA, so I know some of you have heard. Okay. This whole concept is the idea of doing little things where you feel like you've made progress, but you're kind of still putting off the big thing or the hard task. Anybody ever done that? They have a to-do list and they're like, well, I've got these five really easy things. I'm going to focus on doing the easy and maybe avoiding the bigger thing. But I feel like I've accomplished something. Because I've done the easy, like a few of the easy stuff. Anybody ever done that? I've done that with my to-do list. I'm like, I'm just going to do the easy. Well, you need to be aware that you're doing that and be aware that there's terminology. There's actually a term for it, structured procrastination. It's still procrastination if you're putting something off. So be mindful of that. And the other thing is multitasking. There's a lot been said about this recently. A lot of people say it's not all that maybe people think that it is. Have y'all heard anything about multitasking? What does that mean?
Doing many things at once.
Doing things. Trying to do a lot of things
like
at once.
Like driving and texting.
Yeah. Have y'all heard of multitasking?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. So what they're saying now is nobody really truly multitasks. Mm-hmm. You really can only do and only focus on one absolute thing at a time. It's interesting, computers, somebody was telling me, computers are the same way. You think your computer's doing a whole bunch of stuff, but it really, you know, is a one-time process, and then it moves on to the next process. It does it super fast, but it's usually just doing kind of one thing at a time. The other thing that I thought was interesting about switching tasks is for people who, let's say you're doing a big task, but then you're working for 30 minutes, and you decide to text a friend, or you decide to answer an email, and then you work on it maybe 15 minutes longer, and then you go back to email, or you go to texting, whatever it is. They found that switching between tasks in that way reduces an IQ score temporarily by 5 points for women and up to 15 points for men. Y'all hear that? So if you're switching tasks, if you're not focused and you're switching to something like texting or email, some sort of technology, then in the long term, it's not going to be as productive. You know, you may end up being distracted by that. You may get derailed from what you're doing. So it's good to focus at one time. And one of the pieces of advice also on that is if you need a break, sometimes you've been working for an hour, working for 2 hours, we all get tired. We get bored, right? Everybody's been bored or tired from doing stuff, homework maybe. They say it's best for you to take a break, maybe close your eyes, and don't look at your phone. Don't look at technology. Just close your eyes, have a moment or two by yourself, and just think about things that are important to you, things that you care about. Maybe a little bit of meditation, if you're into that, you can do that. But just having sort of a mental quiet and calm, and that's really what's going to rest you and prepare you to finish that project. Make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the IQ thing, I was pretty shocked by that. Men are losing 10 points if you're on a task and then you're distracting yourself with texting, or 15 points, that's a lot. So, the marshmallow experiment. Does anybody know about the marshmallow experiment? Anybody taking psychology?
Psychology.
I don't remember the marshmallow experiment. Oh, no. Okay. So, maybe, I don't know, maybe talk here. Linda knows about it. Yeah. So, the marshmallow experiment. This is something they did in the 60s and the 70s to 4- and 5-year-olds. And what they did was they put kids in a room and they said, okay, kid, here's this marshmallow. If you eat it now, that's fine. You can have the marshmallow. But if you wait for 15 minutes, I'll give you an extra marshmallow. The person left the room for 15 minutes, came back, and checked on the kids. So, of course, some of the kids waited, you know, and were able to hold out. Other kids couldn't resist. They ate the marshmallow, didn't get the second marshmallow. They couldn't hold out. So this whole idea is delayed gratification. The idea, if you can delay something for the greater good of getting something done or getting more out of it in the end. So interesting experiment. Is anybody, does that ring bells with anybody after hearing it?
Yeah,
maybe you heard it, what I'm doing to you guys right now, maybe?
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah, so I know some people came in late. I told people, if you want to take a piece of candy now, you can, that's fine. But if you wait, you can have more candy at the end. So I'm experimenting on you guys without your permission, which is kind of bad. I hope nobody minds. But anyways, so this is a good quote I found. Success usually comes down to choosing the pain of discipline over the ease of distraction. And that's exactly what delayed gratification is all about. The other thing with the marshmallow experiment, they decided, because I think a logical question with the marshmallow experiment is, so was there something about the kids who delayed the gratification intrinsically? Like, were they just born with this marshmallow delayed reaction skill? Or, you know, or is there something about their environment that's made them like that? The whole nurture versus nature argument. So some more researchers decided, okay, we're going to check back in on this and see what we can decide. And actually, going back to the marshmallow experiment, they checked in on those kids, those 4- and 5-year-olds, years later. Again, this was originally done in the 60s and 70s, so they've talked to them, I think, throughout their lives. The people who delayed the marshmallow and waited for the second one, those kids later in life, they had higher SAT scores, they had more success, they had lower rates of obesity, better social skills, they were less likely to have addictive behavior. They had all sorts of levels of success. So, the second experiment brings us to the whole, was there something about those kids that they were just born to be able to have delayed gratification? So the second group of experimenters, what they did was they had a group of kids and they did something with stickers where they said, okay, here's a sticker. I'm going to come back in a few minutes, and if you wait on the sticker, I'll bring you more stickers. Well, the researcher came back, and he said, oh, I forgot the stickers, or I don't have any. So anyways, then they did another testing where they said, okay, I've got some cookies. If you eat one now, that's okay. You won't get any more, but if you delay, I'm going to bring you some more. Well, the researcher came back and said, oh, I ran out of cookies, or I can't find the cookies. Sorry about that. And then they kept on with more and more. So what happened at the end when they got to the marshmallows, most of the kids by the end said, okay, I don't really trust this researcher guy. It's not really stable. I'm going to go ahead and eat this marshmallow because I don't think he's really going to bring me back any. So what that tells us, and actually they did another experiment where they had stickers with the kids, and the researcher did bring the stickers to the kids at the end, and then they did bring the cookies, they did bring the marshmallows, and those kids by the marshmallows, they were able to delay the gratification. They were able to learn that delayed gratification even just through that short experiment. So what does that tell us? That tells us that you can train your brain on delayed gratification. That's not something that is just, oh, some people have it, some people don't. That means that you can teach yourself that. Can teach yourself to delay rewards and be conscious of that. So, I know we are close. Wow, we still have 7 minutes. Okay, I was worried about time. What do you guys think?
That's self-control.
Self-control, teaching that.
I can control myself. Mm-hmm. Wow, it's can't control anything, basically.
Well, most children have a harder time at self-control. They haven't learned it yet.
Yeah.
Most grown-ups don't have it either.
Yeah, and if you think about, just depending on the environment, if a kid is raised where they've been told, okay, you're going to get this, and then maybe an adult isn't following through on promises for delayed gratification, then that's going to be harder for them. They can still learn it later in life, but they're going to have to be conscious that it's something they've got to learn. Whereas maybe kids in a situation where it's like, okay, if the parents are following through, they're saying, you know, you're going to get this, or we're going to do this at this time, then, you know, maybe that's something they're already learning intrinsically, don't even realize it. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So how do you guys reward yourselves when you, this is something we did talk about in ACA, having rewards when you're doing stuff. Maybe you've done a big paper and you reward yourself somehow. What do you guys do?
I treat myself like I get something to eat.
You get something to eat? Okay, is it like a special?
Like a something actual, like special kind of thing. Like I'll actually go to a restaurant and treat myself. I'm like, I think I deserve this.
Yes.
I did that whole 3-page paper.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's good. Yeah. See, that's good. Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? How do y'all reward yourself? I know y'all work hard.
I treat myself to Starbucks coffee. I'm a Starbucks coffee.
Where is the Starbucks? Where do you go?
Okay, I would wait next to it. Just gotta go to Starbucks.
Okay. I like that. I know I did something similar when I was a student. It was chai tea. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Who else? What else do y'all do?
Sometimes I just go treat myself to a nice round bag.
Oh, okay. So nice, high-end bags. I like that.
If I've done something that I know I made all A's a semester, then I'll go myself.
Yeah. So you're probably throughout the semester thinking about, I really want that bag. I better study for this test or do the work.
I'll probably buy it anyway. But okay. I leave it and not buy it until I'm ready to grad. So that way look something to look forward to.
Right. Okay, something to, I think we all need something to look forward to, right? To move this. Okay, who else? What else do you guys do?
I just praise myself.
Okay. Yeah. Do you look in the mirror and do self talk? Or?
Yeah. You know, nice. You must have props.
It is cheaper to do
that. That really is cheaper.
I would save money.
I mean, if I want something to drink, I'm not going to get something to eat or drink. But I mean, but I just praise myself because normally you don't get praise
from your bag,
from anywhere else. I mean, it's fascinating, but you know, it's not like we're kids and our parents. Mm-hmm. You know, so, you know, I praise myself, build myself up.
Good. So what kind of things do you say, if you don't mind?
Well, I mean, I'm like, yay, I did it. Or you know, and then, you know, if I didn't do good, I'm like, oh, daggone, I got to do harder next time. I mean,
just have a good moment of, like, kind of positivity for yourself.
Okay. Just me and my inner self.
It's better that, like, that. I give myself a pat on the back, too. Like, this morning, I was like, like these past 2 weeks, I had like this big test for this class, and I was like, oh, I'm so focused. I mean, I had to like, I was putting off a lot of stuff on the side, like social stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And then this morning, I'm like, oh, I got like an actual 100. Like, I got like my essay. He was like, oh, it's very impressive and everything. I'm like, wow, all that hard work, all that studying, those times that I went to the library and study and like, it pays off. I'm like, man, that's good.
Yeah, good for you.
Yeah.
Okay, well, unless anybody has any questions, that's all I've got. I've also got a little cheat sheet of some of the things that I mentioned that Dr. Ariely has, so I'll give that to you guys. Hold on to.
I'm passing.
And do
what? I said it, I'm passing.
Oh, yeah, you can pass it.
What is
and, yep, that's for y'all. That's just for y'all to hold on to in case it's helpful. Mm-hmm.
And two more.
Yeah.
And one back here.
Okay. And then the candy is now you guys for listening. So take as much as you want. I got a pretty big bag of candy, so I hope you guys will take one.
Oh, don't you worry. I will make sure I take
one. I'll make sure I take one, too.
I am. Yep,
you can go ahead and do the evaluations, please.
Okay.